Hello there, love bugs. Hello there, Bellas. If you have not already done so, please remember to like, share, and subscribe because it is so important to our success here on the YouTube. And if you are not already a part of our book club, please remember to hit the Patreon link below and or the join button here on the YouTube. And for a small monthly fee, you babies, yes, you can be privy to all the shenanigans before the YouTube gets it, if the YouTube gets it. Now, let's talk about I, Tina, My Life Story, Tina Turner with Kurt Loder. And I think this is part 20. Okay. So, love bugs, keep this in mind. Next Friday, we're going to have a members only meeting on YouTube Live between 12 and 3 because we need to discuss the next book. Okay. Then before we get started, I want to also kind of clear up some things in regards to Miss Robbie. Okay. A lot of you guys, in the comment section, you guys were shocked about the fact that Miss Robbie had set Tina Turner up. Okay. Because what happened was, just a quick refresher, Tina Turner, left Ike and moved in with a friend. When Ike found out where she was living, Ike had contacted Miss Robbie. Okay, Robbie. Now, Robbie is scared of him. I don't understand why everybody is so scared of that fucking ickity ikity. You ain't had no daggone thugs in your... Miss Robbie, that's bullshit. You got thugs because your son is a whole damn killer around here. And I ain't even trying to make jokes about that, girl. I'm not even trying to make jokes about that. But there's no reason as to why Miss Robbie should be terrified of a man that she not hunching. Okay, but anyway, he contacted Miss Robbie. Robbie, I need you to tell Tina to come talk to me. Robbie, Aileen, her sister, and I think her mother too, has said, come on, let's go pull this fugazi stunt. Okay, Robbie knocked on the door, knock, knock, knock. Tina Turner opened up the door, saw behind Miss Robbie. Oh, there go that ickity ikity. She here to try to convince me to talk to Ike because Ike knew how much Tina Turner cared for Miss Robbie, okay? So Tina Turner didn't have anger or anything in her heart, you know, hateful towards Miss Robbie because, you know, everybody was scared of Ike. So she was not, she was not surprised that Ike had contacted Robbie, her sister, and her mother to convince her to talk about or to talk to Ike. Okay, so going forward, I just didn't want you guys to have any type of, you know, bad feelings or hard feelings towards Miss Robbie because she was obviously scared of Ike. You know, it wasn't a setup thing. It was more so Robbie was scared to tell Ike no. Okay, so moving forward. Okay, you know that Tina has left, right? And Tina now knows that Ike is being pursued legally for the canceled date that was scheduled for the Ike and Tina review. Okay, so Ike is dealing with the lawsuits, and Ike is now dealing with taking care of the boys by himself. Okay, 2 days after their meeting in the car, Ike sent all four of the children to live with Tina. Okay, she said that that Ike sent the boys with no, did she give them clothes? So he did send the pajamas, their pets, you know, and other little bull stuff, but no furnishings, no plate, or no spoon. That sounds crazy to me. I'm sure that lady got a couch over there, a bed over there, you know, and if she don't have a bed over there, put them little boys in the sleeping bags. Little boys is dirty. They sleep any damn way. They sleep in the back of a car, yeah. But anyway, Tina was saying that they would need such things soon, okay? Tina felt she could no longer impose on Miss Anna Marie at this point. To Tina's surprise, I gave her $1,000 to rent a small house for the kids on Sunset Crest Drive in Laurel Canyon, okay? So, you know, yes, you cannot impose on people like that because, you know, it's Tina there now in that Lady Anna Marie house. It's her four boys there, but I know everybody was shocked because when I read it, I was like, what? I gave her a little bit of money to take care of her children? What the hell? That is a terrible place. Y'all, don't you ever, anybody within my voice, ladies, don't you ever give a man your money that you have to rely on him to give you your money back. You was out there on the strip sucking all that dick, okay? You was out there on the strip, selling all that, pustanka. Not him, okay? Stop giving these niggas all your money. Tina says that it was a strategy. She says, of Ike's gesture, he gave me enough money for 1 month's rent and figured I have to start working with him again when the next months came due. I was way ahead of him, though. Completely on her own now, she called back Rhonda Graham. Unemployed since bailing out of Ike's world, to her, her reestablishing her career was priority. Their first order of business was to create cash flow. Since it had been Tina who walked off the final review tour and not Ike, she suddenly found herself legally liable for reimbursing all the promoters who had scheduled and advertised the tour now canceled dates, okay? Court papers were pouring in, but Tina had no money to pay. Her professional situation was similarly grim. The Ike and Tina Turner name was now mud with the promoters. As a solo act, Tina herself was an unknown commodity at the age of nearly 37. Damn! I didn't know Tina Turner was that damn old. She found herself starting over at the bottom of the business, okay? So what it sounds like to me is that and by the way, I have so much respect for Tina Turner. This is why I see so many women love Tina Turner, because they can see themselves in her, because she is someone who has made mistakes, enjoyed her life, fell from grace, and then found her way back. You know, so that in itself, despite all the, the lies and the shenanigans that she's trying to make us believe in this book, she really reestablished herself, okay? Because, yeah. Now, Rhonda Graham is back. And what she said was, okay, so Tina Turner, she ain't have no band. She ain't have, nothing. No wardrobe, no nothing. She was a mess. Right? So what she said she would do is to overbook her for the TV guest appearances, which I kind of believe now, or that I kind of remember now, because they said that she was a regular on the Hollywood Squares, she did some shows on the Brady Bunch variety show, Donnie and Marie, and the Cher show, and Laughing Revival. So I can kind of now see her there, on these shows by herself, gaining money and trying to reestablish herself as a solo person. So whoever Rhonda Graham is, whoever her business lady is, kudos to you. You know what? I think I might be a bad manager when I get finished reading all these books, because I'm starting to know about the business now, y'all. Now, this is how it worked between the two. How many minutes? Now, this is how it worked between the two. Okay, Tina Turner, she getting a little bit of money, but she's on food stamps. Shock and awe, y'all. Shock and friggin' awe. Okay, Rhonda is getting unemployment every 2 weeks. And this is why I see why Tina Turner took that damn Rhonda right with her. Because at the end of the month, between them, if they had $12 left, Tina would split those $12. Six for you, Rhonda, and six for me. Because what was going on, because she had all them, in that debt in regards to canceling those dates. I'm like, damn, that's messed up too. Because Tina was the person to cancel it. So therefore, Tina has to be responsible for the money. That's only fair. Now, now, it would be kind of Ike to help her out. But he not going to help her. He not going to do that. Bitch, you pay the bills. You the reason why the Ike and the Tina ain't together no more. You pay the shit. It must have been late August when we went up to Las Vegas to see Aunt Margaret. This is Rhonda Graham talking, y'all. We just wanted to get away from L.A. and the Ike thing for a couple of days. But after Anna's show, we were back in her dressing room and the phone rang. "Tina, it's Ike." Well, you could have heard a pin drop. We thought, oh no, he even tracked her down here. Now let me tell you something about Aunt Margaret. Aunt Margaret don't like that ninja Ike, okay? Aunt Margaret don't give two craps about that ninja Ike, okay? Because Ike can maybe scare all them, but he don't scare me or my husband, Roger Smith, okay? Roger Smith knew of this divorce lawyer that would tell Iggy Iggy, "Man, you, like I said, bruh, you got all them people scared, but you do not scare nobody over here, Iggy Iggy." And I respect that. This Leeds, hold tight, so I'm gonna give you a couple of things about this man, because Leeds is not backing down. That lawyer ain't backing down. Okay, when Leeds of the Los Angeles law firm of Gottlieb, Locke, and Leeds entered the divorce proceedings on Tina's behalf at the end of August, he was startled by the state of her suit. Under California law, she was entitled to half the Turner's community property. Can't you see Iggy Iggy or Lawrence the Fishburne just sweating in court? Sweating and stuttering. That's what I see, child. What you mean? What you mean? Who this nigga anime? Who this nigga anime? Where'd you find this nigga at? Now, the problem between Leeds and Tina the Turner was that Tina the Turner was just like, "I just want to be free from Ike. That's all I want. Another one. I think I got like, I got three more chapters left, baby." And unless they got some more divorce, you know, situations going. No, they don't. Because I didn't. No, they don't. They ain't never say in this book that she was like, "All I want is my name. Just my name." Remember in the movie, y'all? Where Ike was like, "You can't have my name. I gave you that name. You can't." And nothing in this book said, "All I want is my name." No. Tina Turner just wanted to be free of that ninja and his persecutelage, okay? And to live her life. Shit. Leeds was like, "That ain't enough. That ain't enough. I'm your lawyer, girl. Do you know you got the heaviest, hottest lawyer in the University of the State of Universal California? Girl, do you know what I could get you? I could get you everything you want. And you keep talking this BS to me about all you want is your freedom? Girl, go home and take a drink, girl." Tina says that I called Arthur that motherfucking Leeds. He did not like him because Arthur couldn't be scared away. He had a couple of meetings in his office, and Ike was raising all kinds of hell. But Arthur talked right back to him. Finally, we went to court, and I testified for about 5 minutes, just stated my name, the details of the merge, and I was prepared to give everything away to that man. And when the judge found this out, he called Arthur and me into his chamber. He said, "Young lady, are you sure?" You know why the judge said that? Because the whole goddamn world know that, excuse me, Iggy Iggy was taking a chunk of your ass every goddamn night. And all you gonna do is just walk away when you are entitled to ABC. And I know you're like, "Nay, why she gotta have half?" For real, she need more than half. Okay, because if it was not for the Tina and the Turner entering into, what was the name of his group? The Kings of Rhythm or something like that. Them motherfuckers would still be the Kings of Rhythm. Okay, but okay, all right. I'm not here to understand. I'm just here to let you guys know. This is another reason why I say I truly understand why you women love Tina the Turner. Wait. Here we go. So we back in chambers, right, with the judge. Okay, the judge say, "You sure this is what you want?" She said, "No, I just want my peace of mind. Then she goes, "Judge, I'm positive, okay?" But then she go, "Hold on, wait a minute, I got an idea." Then I said, "Actually, there is something he has that I want." "What is it you say, Nene?" "Hold on. You see, Ike always kept the presents that people gave me. And he had some crystal jewelry that belonged to me in his safe at the studio. But then Ike said he didn't know anything about it." That's what you want, girl? Don't nobody give a fuck about no crystal jewelry, girl. If it ain't from your mammy or your daddy, Who cares? Don't nobody give a fuck about no dude. Y'all, I'm telling you, the movie then threw us in a trick bag, y'all. So the next thing I did was call Mike Stewart, the head of United Artists, our former record company. Ike was negotiating a new record deal as we were not under contract to anyone at the time of the split. Mike asked me to come to his office to meet with Ike and discuss what was going to be done. I went, and that's where I told Ike, that not only was I never coming back to live with him, I wasn't going to work with his ass no more either. You can hang that up, Ickity Ikey. What you think? You going to be mean to me and I'm going to sing for you? You can kiss my ass on Sunday. And that's when the trouble started, okay? Because what she was saying was going on was that he was not only torturing her, the children, and Rhonda, but his ass was like, I mean, he was like 10 of properties and everything, shooting guns through people's car windows, all kinds of mess. That damn Ickity Ikey, oh my God, that Scorpio, he needs some help, girl. He was breaking windows out of people's cars and houses and shooting shotguns into people's houses. That nigga is crazy, okay? Arthur Leeds says that some detectives from the homicide squad came to see me too. They said an undercover agent had heard that Ike had hired a guy to kill Tina. You say what? Yes, y'all. Yes, this ninja was so mad at Tina Turner that he was like, fuck it, bitch, if you ain't gonna make no money with me, you ain't gonna make no money at all. I don't care if you my baby mama. You know how many baby mamas I got? Ooh, that Ickity Ikey, y'all. So anyway, back to the dude, Mike Stewart, okay? Mike Stewart agreed to help and advance her, meaning Tina Turner, a sizable sum to mount a stage show. Since the most easily accessible market, given Tina's solo status and immediate financial requirements, was the cabaret circuit, okay? So, I can see that because, you know, I can see that being a big thing then. And then y'all know this is when Tina had did the Disco Inferno. Burn, baby, burn. Burn his mother out or down. Something like that. What's the name? The song by the Tramps. Yeah, Disco Inferno. Is that the lady with the dog? Child, because I can't wait to see this one lady, child. Is that her? Because if she got a damn dog, because I can't stand when trifling people live in luxury areas. You know, bitch, we got a dog walk, park right downstairs. All you got to do is get on the elevator. Why you letting the dog shit on the damn parking deck? Okay, excuse me, y'all. Anyway, in her cabaret show, she did Disco Inferno, River Deep, Proud Mary, Honky Tonk Woman, A Fool in Love, You're Just a Fool. You know you're in love, what you say. Hey, 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 hey. So, where the play started off was going to be this, or where the tour or the cabaret tour started off, it was going to be this club in Vancouver, British Columbia. Okay, that's good. That's over there. You know they love her ass over there. Okay, they love her over there. Tina says that she got great reviews and got standing ovations for the first time in her life. She says, I don't remember standing ovations when I was with Ike. Child, now, if she really ain't secure with leaving that nigga, she's super secure now. Now, back to the divorce proceedings. You know that goddamn Leeds. Arthur Leeds ain't letting up off that ninja Ickity Ikey. He is contacting Ickity Ikey. Ickity Ikey, let me tell you something. I don't believe that you drive a Datsun. I don't believe that you drive a Datsun 210, bruh. Why do you have all these Rolls Royces and Bentleys in your driveway? You got all these furs. Tina say you got her furs, her Crystal Jewelry. You got all this stuff going on. I need you to talk about your assets in reality, because the lawyer Leeds think that his assets is $750,000. Damn, that's it? Ooh, that ain't no money. Is it a month or is it a year?
Hold on, y'all.
Well, whatever it was, she was only making $100,000 and he was making $750. So Lee said, you can kiss my ass with that, bruh. You know you got money. Now, Tina was starting to make money on the cabaret circuit. But whatever wasn't plowed back into band salaries and production costs had to be earmarked for payback to the promoters of the last Ike and Tina tour. Okay? So you see what she's going through. I'm telling you, I am in love with this woman that, well, I'm going to say I'm in love with her because I remember being young and seeing my mother struggle. I was smart and young enough to, I was young, but I was smart enough to know that my mother was struggling. So I never asked her for anything. Okay. We had the basics, but I never asked her for anything because I knew, you know what I'm saying? That's going to be a problem for her down the line. But you know, when there's so much debt there, you know, where you end up paying for some bullshit that your husband is half responsible for, or, you know, he added to the debt. But that's what them ninjas will do to you, y'all. That's what they will do. They will leave you holding the bag of doodle. You know, I love you men. I know y'all think I don't like men, but I like men too. In fact, it's easier to deal with a dude than it is a female, because dude be so dumb, he do the dumb shit in your face. When you deal with women, you walk up on it like cat piss. You just walk to the house, you know, and you be cleaning up, and then you look at the corner and there goes some cat pee or doo-doo, okay? The divorce dragged on for a while longer, though, with Ike continuing to butt heads with Arthur Leeds and going through 5 different lawyers of his own in the process. Tina continued touring profitable clubs to pay off her debt to all the stiffed tour promoters, to Mike Stewart, and to maintain her bag, her band. Don't forget, she's paying Mike Stewart because Mike Stewart of her former label gave her the seed money to start that cabaret type tour. Okay, so she has to pay him back through the money that she's making. She has to pay back all the promoters that, you know, still waiting on that money from all the canceled dates. She got the boys, okay? She's on food stamps. It's basically just her and Rhonda trying to make it together. For the 4 boys, life with mother was a strange new world. All their lives, they'd been surrounded by the glittery tokens of their parents' showbiz success. The lavish house, the big cars, and of course, there had always been housekeepers to tidy up. Tina's new circumstances were Spartan by comparison, and she even expected them to help with the housework. The kids, especially Michael, the hardest hit by Ike and Tina Turner's split, was disoriented and rebellious. In his increasing silences, Tina knew she was losing control of her children. Now, if you have not already done so, please remember to like, share to Facebook, and subscribe, because it is so important to our success here on the YouTube. Now, remember this. The same people that you meet on the way up will always be the same people that you meet on the way down. My naysayers, my patron loves, you babies, y'all better have a good one. Peace.